The words come from a profound American author and poet, Wendell Berry. What we need is here. What we need is here. What we need is here. Just two verses like that, that just keep repeating. I'm going to ask you to sing it with me. I'm also going to ask for my mic to go off so we can just hear each other singing. I don't want to hear anyone say, I can't sing. I don't want to hear anyone say that I don't sound very good when I sing, because the psalmist says to make a joyful noise to God, not a perfect one, not an in-tune one. I want us to listen to one another. So listen to me sing it one more time and then you can join. What we need is here. What we Amen. Advent conspiracy, wondering what it means to live as a people of Advent. This is a really great project online. The tagline, 'tis the season to turn your Christmas upside down. It's hard to be an Advent, to wait for something that by all rights starts somewhere in October in most of our stores, especially right after Thanksgiving, the season of Christmas. But as Christians, we're somewhat subversive by waiting during the season of Advent. What does it mean to live as an Advent people? What does it mean to live as a people of hope in the midst of despair? From the earliest rumblings of the Jesus movement that we would eventually call Christianity, people listened to prophets in their midst. And not prophets in this Nostradamus type way that we normally think of. Somebody who predicts the future. They might read your palm and they might charge you for it. Prophets in the Bible are different. They are people called by God to speak the word of God. Let me say that again. Prophets are people called by God to speak the word of God. And we have a lot of prophets, and we hear them throughout the season of Advent. We hear Isaiah and others. These are people who were not liked. This is a modern-day prophet, Phyllis Tickle. She's incredible. She's in her mid-80s, and she still challenges me on a lot of stuff. She's a fireball from the South. And she speaks a word of God that's enough on the edge that people don't like her. In fact, there are a lot of people who hate her, who send her messages, send her hateful anonymous emails. They wouldn't be these prophets. They're not liked. They would not be the first ones elected as our church council president, for instance. They're not easy to get along with. Okay, they probably wouldn't make it through the entrance exam into seminary. These prophets. Well, I mean, not like Pastor Janice or Pastor Haley Vey. We assume that was a joke, y'all. She went through. She's ordained. Okay. Some prophets were even murdered for doing this job, this act of speaking truth. There are a lot of them in our tradition. Isaiah, Jeremiah, Ezekiel, Deborah, Miriam. And there's a prophet named Amos. Now, this is down the road in Washington, D.C., Dr. King's memorial. It's interesting because this quote here is not from him, it's from Amos. But it was such a, within the fabric of his ministry, of his social justice proclamation. See, Martin Luther King Jr. was a prophet who spoke the word of God. That we tend to think of it as a quote from him, but it's actually from Amos. Amos was a sheep herder from a well-to-do part of Israel called Tekoa. He was actually in a position of power, and he gives all that up to preach the word of God, to be a prophet. Now, at this time, Israel was split into two communities, Israel in the north, Judah in the south. And his opening statement is this powerful critique. Amos critiques the people of God, but he does so in this way that he gets them into this sort of rhythm, a downbeat of denunciation against their enemies first. I mean, right? It's so much easier to just rip on the ones we don't like, the ones we have labeled as enemies, the ones that have labeled as enemies by other people. I mean, it's how us versus them, right? I mean, it's easy to rip on our enemies. But then Amos turns it on the people listening to him, on the people of God. I want us to experience it today. I've been learning pieces of the book of Amos. I want to think about how a slam poem of ridicule then turns around and asks us to question ourselves. The words of Amos, a shepherd from Tekoa, concerning Israel in the days of King Uzziah of Israel and King Jeroboam, Joash, the son of Judah. 2 years before the earthquake, Amos said, "The Lord roars from Zion. God's voice utters from Jerusalem. The pastures of the shepherds wither. The top of Carmel dries up. Thus says the Lord." For three transgressions of Damascus, and for four I will not revoke the punishment. For three transgressions of Damascus, and for four I will not revoke the punishment. Because they threshed Gilead with threshing sledges of iron. Right? They moved where they were not to go. So I'll send a fire on the house of Hazael, including and enveloping the strongholds of Ben-Hadad. And the people of Aram will go into exile and to Kir, says the Lord. Thus says the Lord. Thus says the Lord. For three transgressions of Gaza, and for four I will not revoke the punishment. For three transgressions of Gaza, and for four I will not revoke the punishment. Because they rounded up entire communities to hand them over to Edom. So I'll send a fire on Gaza. It will devour their strongholds. I'll turn my hand against Ekron. And the Philistines who remain there, I will kill them, says the Lord. Thus says the Lord. Thus says the Lord. For three transgressions of Judah. For three transgressions of Judah, and for four, I will not revoke the punishment, because they rejected the law of the Lord. They didn't keep God's statutes. They were led astray by the same lies after which their ancestors walked. So I'll send a fire on Judah, and it will devour the strongholds of Jerusalem. For three transgressions of Israel, and for four, I will not revoke the punishment, because they sell the righteous for silver and the needy for a pair of sandals. They who grind the head of the poor into the dust of the earth and push the afflicted out of the way. They lay themselves beside altars, dressed in garments taken on pledge. They drink wine in the house of their God, bought with fines they imposed. When I first started learning the story of Amos, I was startled by this. See, the whole entire chapter one of Amos, it's like seven of these against Israel's enemies. So imagine for a second how they kind of got into this rhythm, right? Yeah, yeah, forget those people. Yeah, yeah, those people. And then it stops with them. It turns around, and God calls Judah and Israel to something greater. As provocative as these prophetic words are, they have been kept by generations of Christians and Jews. We could just easily cut these words out of our Bibles, or at the very least out of our lectionaries. But here they are. And I think it has something to say to us, especially during Advent. Now, this is not a plug, but it is a plug. This is a part of our online ministry that we do down in Baltimore, and we're inviting people to follow along during Advent using that that hashtag we call the a digital discipline. And you see, it goes all the way to 24, December 24th. See, it's a powerful thing to wait for Christmas, especially when everybody and everywhere and everything is telling us that Christmas is already here, to wait for it. It's a powerful image during Advent to wait. And it calls us to wait. There is a time of waiting in Advent. And yet, in our thing-driven society, obsessed with instant gratification, we rarely get a chance to wait for anything. This is St. John Chrysostom calling out the materialism that had kind of covered the churches in his day 1,700 years ago. There is a time of waiting for us to overcome racism, as deeply entrenched as it is in our society and country. Now, here's the deal. This is a funny picture, y'all. Okay? But it says something deep in it. All right? Destroy racism. Be like a panda. He's black. He's white. He's Asian. And he's chubby. It's great. It's also powerful, though, because it's asking us to destroy racism. I don't have the answers here. We're trying to figure out together, what does it mean to be a people of God in a country and a world that experiences this? How can we destroy racism? See, this is a time of waiting, and yet for many of our black sisters and brothers, the wait for justice in this country has lasted way too long. What does it mean for us who proclaim that God created humankind in God's image, that we have this disparity in imprisonment brought to us by the sentencing project? See, there's a time of waiting in Advent. What does it mean for us? See, Amos's words, which aren't Amos's at all, remember, but God's, right? He's called to preach God's word. They echo this frustration. Amos doesn't just call Israel's enemies to task. He calls Israel itself to task. Being in Advent doesn't ask us just to calmly wait, but to work towards that for which we wait. Being in Advent asks us to be uncomfortable, like Amos's audience, and ask the question, how often do we point the finger? I'm turning into my grandpa now. Huh? How often do we point the finger without recognizing that there are three fingers pointing back at us? Being in Advent asks us not just to talk about justice in some ideological way, but to work for it, to get down and dirty. Being in Advent asks us not just to recognize the power and responsibility given to those who work as police officers in our country, but also to recognize the deep flaws in a system that has led to millions of people protesting peacefully, but with holy anger these last few days because of events from Ferguson, Missouri to Staten Island, New York, just to name a few. What does it mean for us to hear these cries and to join in them, to hear Amos's words, which are words from God? Being in Advent asks us to wait. Wait for our world to maybe turn upside down. Wait for an Advent conspiracy. I love this word conspiracy. It's related to the word inspiration. So inspiration is two Latin words. In means in. Inspire means breathe. Right? So inspiration is something that's breathed in. Well, then conspiration, right, is something that's breathed together. But that's not a word, conspiration. But that's con with breathing. So breathing with each other is really a conspiracy. Now, we normally have a negative view of this word conspiracy. But think about that. Inspiration's great. But I think a Christian community is a conspiracy. We breathe together. So what does it mean to live as a people of hope in the midst of despair? What does it mean to live as an Advent people?
Okay. So go on.
Yep.
The beginning.
Someday.
The good news of Jesus, the Christ, the Son of God. I'm sending my messenger ahead of you to prepare your way. The voice of one crying, prepare the way of the Lord. Make his paths straight.
Oh, darn.
Hey, Hosanna! Away!
John the Baptizer appeared in the wilderness, proclaiming a baptism of repentance for the forgiveness of sins. And people from the whole Judean countryside and everyone from Jerusalem were going out to him, were baptized by him in the River Jordan, confessing their sins.
The preacher said, "All my sins is washed away, including that Piggly Wiggly I knocked over in Yazoo."
"I thought you said you was innocent of those charges."
"Well, I was lying. And the preacher said that that sin's been washed away too."
Now, John was clothed with camel's hair, with a leather belt wrapped around his waist.
"I apologize for my appearance. I've had a few setbacks."
He ate locusts and wild honey. He announced, "One who is more powerful than I is coming after me. I'm not worthy to bend down and untie the straps of his sandals. I baptize you with water."
"God, this water is good. Terry, have you tried the water?"
"Shut up, Alan."
"He'll baptize you with Holy Spirit.
When I touch the water, they tell